Chapter 1 of Three Sides of Paradise Green. Three Sides of Paradise Green by Augusta Huiell Seaman. Chapter 1. The Journal is Begun. November 22nd, 1913. It's all on account of Miss Cullingford that I'm beginning this journal. I never would have thought of such a thing by myself. Neither would Carol. Now we've both begun one, and it's just because Miss Cullingford is so sweet and lovely, and all the girls at Bridgeton High School want to please her, Carol and myself most of all. Miss Cullingford is our English literature instructor, and we all simply adore her. She's the sweetest thing. She's little and slight, with puffy light hair and dark blue eyes. And she's such an inspiration about literature and English composition. She makes it seem actually like a romance. They always seemed terribly dull, those subjects, when we had Miss Trotter last year, but now we're just crazy about them. Well, one of the things she said yesterday in composition class was that every one of us ought to keep a journal, not the kind of diary affair that some people keep, all about the weather and the number of jars of jam they put up and how Cousin Hannah called that day, but an occasional record, only written when we felt like it, of the things that happen around us and our ideas about people and so on. She said that the greatest minds of the ages had generally kept such a record, and that they had proved a big addition to history and literature, too. Then, right there, I raised my hand and said that it was fine, of course, for the great minds to do it, especially when they lived in stirring times and had lots interesting to write about. But what was the use of just plain ordinary people, as young as we were, doing it, especially when there wasn't anything going on that was interesting at all? Just the same old thing every day. Miss Cullingford answered that I mustn't make the mistake of thinking any life uninteresting, no matter how quiet and ordinary it might appear to be. You can always find something interesting to write about any kind of life, if you try hard enough. And that was where the advantage of a journal came in. It made you look around hard to find what was worthwhile, and you always found it. Also, it was a great help to your style in writing. Then she asked if any of the girls would promise to keep a journal faithfully for a year. Carol and I promised. Well, now I'm going to see. No life could possibly be more uninteresting than mine, here in quiet little Stafford, where nothing ever happens, or ever has happened that I know of, and in a family that's awfully nice, of course, but as plain and uninteresting and ordinary as all the rest of the families around here. Carol doesn't feel the same as I do about it. She's more hopeful. That's because she has lots of imagination and is always romancing about people and thinking there's some story back of their lives that we don't know. I suppose her journal will be awfully different from mine. Well, anyhow, we've both begun, and now we'll see what happens. November 23rd. I had to stop short last night because I suddenly got so sleepy. Now I'll go on. I do wish we lived in Bridgeton, for things surely happen once in a while in a big town like that, or even down in our own village of Stafford itself, and not way out, a mile off on the main road, on this silly little triangle called Paradise Green. Even the trolley doesn't run up this way. That would be something, but there's nothing in the world around here except this little triangle of a green, formed by the turning off of Cranberry Bog Road from the River Road, and the short road that connects the two at the head of the green. I'm sure I don't know why it was ever called Paradise Green. I suppose if I were Carol, I'd find out. She probably will. She's always hunting up historical facts. Even the automobiles don't come along this way. Nearly all of them keep to the state road over on the other side of the river. There are just three houses around the green, one on each side, and not another dwelling anywhere within half a mile. So we haven't many near neighbors. Our house stands at the head of the green. It's a big square house, with a cupola on top and a veranda around all four sides. Father's father built it when that style of house was just beginning to be popular, and everybody thought it was very grand. I hate it myself, because it seems so old-fashioned and dreary compared to those pretty new bungalows they are putting up in Bridgeton. Mother and Father and the imp and I live here. Father does intensive farming. He is just crazy about it, and everyone comes to Birdsey's for ideas on the subject. Dave is my brother. He's 17 and a half, and a very quiet and thoughtful sort of person. All the same, he can do his own share of teasing in a quiet way. He left high school this year because his health wasn't very good, and is helping father with the farming. Next year, he's going to study scientific agriculture at one of the big colleges. I'm secretly awfully fond of Dave, but just at present he pretends to look down on girls as entirely unnecessary articles in the general scheme of things, so Carol and I are letting him severely alone. The imp is my sister. She's 12 years old and a perfect nuisance. Carol and I have named her the imp because she acts just like one. She likes to trot around with us all the time, but we won't have it. It's impossible to have a child of 12 continually hanging on to girls of 15 or 16, and Carol and I simply won't stand it. The imp is fearfully miffed about this, and spends her time thinking up revengeful things to do to us. She makes our lives perfectly miserable sometimes, though we wouldn't let her know it for the world. Carol's house is on the river road side of the green. She lives there with just her mother and her Aunt Agatha. The Fairs are distant relatives of ours, so Carol and I are really cousins. Their house is one of the old style, a real New England farmhouse, and they have a glorious big barn in the back, where we've all played ever since we were babies. One little room off the haymow Carol and I have fixed up as our private den and study. We keep our books and our fancy work there, and her mother gave us an old desk where we do our schoolwork. We always keep the den locked with a padlock, because the imp would like to get in and rummage around. She's as mad as a hatter because she can't. She threatens to climb in the window sometime, but I don't believe she could possibly. If she did, she'd probably break her neck. Carol is 15 years old and I'm 16. Her name is really Caroline, but she hates it and wants to be called Carol instead. She says it's so much prettier. And mine is even worse, Susan. Could anything be more dreadful? I've insisted on being called Suzette, which at least is a prettier French form, but no one except Carol will ever call me that. Everyone now calls me either Susie or Sue, that is, all but the imp. She, of course, knowing how much I detest it, will say nothing but Susan on all occasions. Carol she addresses by the horrible nickname of Cad. Why are some children so irritating, I wonder? The infuriating part is that the imp's own name is really lovely, Helen Roberta, and she knows it, little torment that she is. Well, I haven't yet told about the third house on the green, so now I come to that. It's the one on the Cranberry Bog roadside. It's by far the most interesting of the three, a long, rambling colonial farmhouse, built, they say, way back in 1700 and something. It has the most fascinating additions in all directions from the main part, and queer little back stairways, and old slave quarters, and I don't know what else, but the people who live in it are the interesting part. To begin with, there's Lewis. His whole name is Lewis Charles Durant. He is 17 and goes to high school in Bridgeton with us. We have known him all our lives, and he's the nicest, jolliest boy we know. But the people he lives with, I've never understood at all, and if there were any romance or mystery about anyone around here, it would be about them. Come to think of it, they are mysterious. Carol has always said so, but I never thought much about it. And that only goes to show that Miss Cullingford is right. Keeping a journal does certainly make you go about with your eyes open wider and gives you an interest in things you never thought worthwhile before. I never thought or cared a bit about Lewis's folks before, and now I see they're full of possibilities. November 24th. Fell asleep again last night while I was writing. I guess it's because there's nothing very exciting to write about. However, I'll go on from where I left off about Lewis's folks. First, there's the old man. Lewis's father and mother have been dead a number of years. I never remember seeing either of them. So he lives with this old man who they say is his guardian. His name is John Meadows, or at least that is what he is always called around here. But Lewis says that he is French, and that his real name is Jean Matteau. He is very old. He must be 80 at least. And he is very feeble now, too. He sits all day in a great armchair by the parlor window. He never reads anything but the papers and some great heavy volumes of French history, but he spends a great deal of time thinking and dreaming while he looks way off over the meadows toward the river. Then there's his daughter, Miss Meadows. She's about 40 or 50 years old, I should think. Louis says her name is Yvonne. Certainly that's a fascinating French name. She's very dark and handsome and quick in her ways, but she's very, very quiet and silent. I never had a real conversation with her in my life, though I've talked to her a great many times. I do all the talking, and she nods or smiles or says yes and no, and that is absolutely all. I feel as if I'd never really know her if I talked to her 100 years. They have one servant, a big French peasant from Normandy, who cooks the meals and takes care of the garden and house. All this doesn't sound very strange, however, and there is something very mysterious about them. At least, so Carol has always said. I never paid much attention to the thing before or noticed it. The curious part of all is the way they treat Louis. He isn't any real relative, so he says. His parents and their parents have just been dear friends from a long way back. It's plain that they think the world of him, too, just as much as if he were a relative. But there's something more. They are continually watching him with anxious eyes. They guard him as if he weren't able to take care of himself any more than a baby. They don't let him have half the liberty and fun that ordinary boys have. Lots of mothers and fathers who love their children to distraction aren't half as fussy and concerned about them as these two people are about a boy who isn't even a relative. It makes Louis awfully annoyed, for he hates like anything to be coddled. Once he fell out of an apple tree and broke a rib, and they nearly went wild. He had a fever that night and lay in a sort of stupor, but when he was coming out of it, he heard them talking awfully queerly about him and wringing their hands and whispering that he would never, never forgive us if Monsieur Louis were to die. Who he was, or why his Aunt Yvonne and his Uncle Jean, as he calls them, should allude to him as Monsieur Louis, was something Louis couldn't understand, and somehow, when he was better, he didn't like to ask. They have taught him French, and with them he has always to speak that language, but he doesn't like it, because he says he's an American citizen and would rather talk United States than anything else. He's awfully patriotic and proud of this country, and he can't understand why this should bother Mr. and Miss Meadows, but it somehow does. He's sure of it, for they won't let him talk about it, and are always telling him that his great-grandfather was born in France, and that he should be very proud of it. Then there's another thing, too, that seems to worry them a lot. Louis is crazy about mechanical engineering. He declares he's going to study that exclusively when he's through high school, and become an expert in it. This nearly drives them wild. They want him to be a statesman, as they call it, and study law and history and diplomacy and all that sort of thing. You can serve your country best that way, they are always telling him. Once he said to them, the United States has plenty of that sort already. I want to go in for something special. And he says they never answered a word, but just looked queerly at each other and walked off. Another time, he found that the lock on their kitchen door wouldn't work, so he unscrewed it and took it out. He was fixing it when along came his Aunt Yvonne. When she saw what he was doing, she burst into tears and rushed away, muttering, "The ancient blood! It will ruin everything!" or something in French like that. All these things do not happen frequently, of course, but when something like it does occur, it puzzles Louis dreadfully. He always talks it over with us when we come home together from Bridgeton High School on the trolley, so that's why I happen to know about it. Well, now I've begun this journal by telling all about ourselves and our homes and everything else I can think of. But as I read it over, it doesn't sound one bit exciting or likely to become an interesting contribution to history, as Miss Cullingford would say. I wonder what she'd think about it. I'm glad I didn't promise to show her my journal, for I'm not very proud of this sample. I'm crazy to see what Carol has written. We're going to compare our journals tomorrow. One thing is certain, though. I'm not going to write another word till I've something more interesting to talk about, even if I have to wait 6 months. End of chapter 1. Chapter 2 of Three Sides of Paradise Green. Three Sides of Paradise Green by Augusta Huiell Seaman. Chapter 2. New Developments. December 1st, 1913. I haven't written a thing in this journal for over a week, for a number of reasons. In the first place, I'd made up my mind not to write till I had something worth writing about. In the second place, we'd been having some exams at school that took a lot of work to prepare for. Third, Thanksgiving holidays came along and we were all pretty busy and had a lot of engagements. Altogether, I haven't had a minute till now, and something has happened that's rather interesting to write about. Carol is ever so much better at this journal business than I am. She writes nearly every other day, but then she doesn't mind writing about all the little ordinary occurrences, the things she does about the housework and her studies and so on. But I simply can't do it. If I can't tell about something a little out of the ordinary, I won't write at all, and as nothing besides the usual ever happens in either one of our two households, or at school or in the village, I find myself turning more and more to Lewis and his affairs for interest. It's strange, I've heard other people speak of the same thing, too, that when you once get to thinking about a certain thing, all sorts of other ideas and events connected with it will suddenly begin to appear. I never gave a thought to Lewis and his affairs before I began this journal. He has always lived here, and we've always known him and never thought there was anything strange about his folks. But now, so many queer little things have happened, and so many strange ideas have come to us, Carol and myself, I mean, about that house across the green, that it seems as if there must be some mystery right near our commonplace lives after all. Before I tell what happened, however, I must remark that the imp has been particularly exasperating lately. She got wind somehow or other, at first we couldn't think how, that Carol and I are keeping journals. Later, I discovered that it was because Carol had carelessly left hers on the desk in our den and had forgotten to padlock the door. Carol is so thoughtless at times because she gets to going about with her head in the clouds, as her Aunt Agatha says, and doesn't remember half the things she ought to do. It's generally when she's thinking up some verses. Carol does compose very pretty verses. Miss Cullingford has praised them highly, but she's always awfully absent-minded when she's thinking about them. Well, the way we learned that the imp had discovered our journals was by a large sheet of paper pinned to Carol's barn door. This was written on it. November 29th. How these precious autumn days fly by. Each one is like a polished jewel. I made my bed and dusted my room at 8 a.m. Then I composed a sweet little poem on feeding the pigs. After that, I slept in the hammock on the porch till lunchtime. The days are all too short for these many duties. Of course, we were furious. Carol confessed to me that she had left her journal open on the desk in the den, and the last entry was awfully like what that little wretch had written, only Carol had spoken of composing a poem on feeding the pigeons. She had slept on the porch all morning, because it was a lovely mild day, and I was away with Mother at a luncheon in Bridgeton, but she hadn't mentioned this in her journal. It is perfectly useless to argue with the imp, or to scold or reason with her. She can go you one better every single time. We concluded that the best thing to do was to ignore the incident entirely. So we left the paper hanging on the barn door till the wind blew it away. A course of action like that makes the imp madder than if you got purple in the face with fury. I've advised Carol not to leave her journal in the den any more, but to keep it in her room, and she says she will. All this, however, isn't telling what happened to Lewis. He told us about it this afternoon while we were resting on our veranda after a hot session of pitching the basketball about. After a while, we just had to sit down and get our breath, and the imp strolled off by herself somewhere. It was then that Lewis told us the strange thing that happened yesterday. It seems that his Aunt Yvonne has gone to New York on a visit for a few days, and he has been alone with his Uncle John and the servant. Yesterday afternoon, about 5 o'clock, a boy rode up from the village on a bicycle with a telegram for his uncle. The old gentleman opened it, but couldn't read it because he had mislaid his glasses. So he got Lewis to read it to him. Lewis says the thing was a cablegram from some place in France. He can't remember the name, and that it was the queerest message. It ran like this. Time almost ripe. Have you the necessary papers? Sail next month. When his uncle heard this, he became terribly excited and began to walk up and down the room very fast. But when Lewis asked him what it all meant, all he would say was, "It is not for you to inquire, or for me to explain just yet, monsieur." Lewis says his uncle often calls him monsieur, and he can't understand why. He thinks it's generally when the old gentleman forgets himself or is excited, but it makes Lewis feel very queer. After that, his uncle wouldn't say anything more, but Lewis says he began to rummage around through all his letters and papers, and looked through all his books and in all the closets, evidently hunting for something he couldn't find. And the more he hunted, the more nervous and excitable he grew. Every once in a while he would exclaim, "Ah, why is not that Ivan here?" By bedtime he was pretty well worked up, for it was evident that he couldn't find what he was searching for. Lewis tried and tried to get him to explain and let him help him in the hunt, but the old gentleman would only mutter, "No, no, that cannot be." Lewis says he doesn't think his uncle slept all night, because he heard him rummaging about in all sorts of places till nearly morning. Today he seems terribly used up. He just sits in his chair by the window, staring out and watching for his daughter to come. Lewis says he had to go down to the village at 8 o'clock last night with a telegram, telling his Aunt Yvonne to come home at once. How mysterious it all sounds! Lewis declares he can't imagine what it means, and it makes him very uneasy, because he is almost certain that it is something concerning himself. He says he sometimes thinks his uncle is planning to send him to France before he gets much older, to complete his studies there and become a French citizen, and he doesn't want to go. My idea was that perhaps he had some relatives there, and that they wanted him to come back. But Lewis says his uncle has often told him that he hasn't any relatives living, and if he had, he says there's no reason why there should be all this secrecy about it. But he can't understand who the people are with whom his uncle is corresponding. Carol's opinion was that perhaps Lewis was a descendant of some titled person, a count or a marquis or something like that, and that these people are trying to bring him back to his legal title and estates. Lewis simply hooted at that. He said that his great-grandfather was a plain monsieur when he came over here long ago, that he never had been anything else and didn't want to be, so that Carol's idea was all nonsense. Carol is always romancing like that, and generally getting laughed at. Just at this point, the imp came suddenly around the corner of the veranda and demanded, "What are you talking about? I warrant dollars to donuts. It's about Lewis." That child has a perfectly uncanny way of lighting on just the thing you don't care to have her know about. She's a veritable mind reader. None of us cared at that particular moment to explain what we were discussing, so no one said a word. Meanwhile, the imp eyed us with a grin, and before anyone could think of something to say that would change the subject, she exploded this bomb in our midst. "Lewis's Aunt Yvonne has come home. She's having a fit." Lewis just scooted for his own house as fast as he could. We asked her how she knew Miss Meadows was having a fit, and she said, "Because I saw her drive up and get out of the hack and run up the steps. I had climbed a tree in their side yard to look into an oriole's nest, and I heard her open the door and call out a lot of things in French to old Mr. Meadows." The imp is terribly quick about picking up languages, and she has teased Lewis into teaching her quite a little French, which he declared to us she picked up with lightning speed. It makes Carol and me furious sometimes to feel that she has this advantage over us, for we haven't come to French yet in high school, and are so busy digging out our Latin that we haven't either time or interest to learn another language on the side. Well, It humiliated me to pieces to have to ask her what Miss Yvonne said, but I swallowed my pride and did so. All the little wretch answered as she walked away was, "Wouldn't you like to know?" We didn't see anything more of Lewis today, and Carol and I are just burning up with curiosity. I could shake the imp till her teeth chattered. There was a cozy group gathered about the open fire in the Birdsies' big, comfortable, and not too tidy living room. At a large center table, drawn close to the blaze, sat Carol and Sue, scribbling away for dear life in two large, fat notebooks, and covering the table with many trial sheets of mathematical figuring. They were exact opposites in appearance. Sue was tall and slim to the point of angularity. She had dark eyes, and her dark hair was coiled heavily about her head. Carol was short and plump, with dreamy blue eyes and wavy auburn hair that still hung in a thick braid. On the davenport, curled up like a kitten in one corner, sat the imp, or Bobs, as she was generally called, her chin propped in her hands, a book balanced against her knees. In sharp contrast to the other two girls was her tiny body and dark, straight hair, and the big blue eyes that could at one moment gaze with liquid, angelic candor, and at the next snap with impish mischief. There was mischief in them at the moment, as she stared reflectively at the two girls bent over the table. Unaware of her gaze, they scribbled on, comparing notes at intervals. "Do you get the answer 4AB, AB plus 2BM, half to your third problem?" presently inquired Sue, without looking up. "No, I don't," moaned Carol in depressed tones, pushing aside her work and running her fingers through her hair. "I don't get anything at all." "Well, don't worry. Let's see what's wrong. Hand over your work, and I'll compare it with mine," said her companion soothingly. She dragged Carol's notebook toward her and compared it with her own. "Oh, I see what you've done," she exclaimed in a moment. "In the first equation, you didn't put down," at this instant, the imp, whose eyes had been smoldering with suppressed mischief, yawned loudly, stretched herself, and remarked with apparent irrelevance, "It's a long day when you don't go to school, isn't it?" Both girls sat up with a jerk and surveyed her sternly. "Do you mean to say that you haven't been to school today?" they demanded in a breath, and Sue added, "I'd like to know why not." "I had a bad headache this morning, Susan," explained the imp sweetly. "Mother let me stay home. I was all right by 2 o'clock, though. Lewis and I had a game of basketball before it began to rain." Her companions glanced at each other with a meaning expression, none of which was lost on the imp. With a grin of satisfaction, she proceeded, "His aunt called him in just before we finished, and he didn't come out again." With a visible effort, Sue inquired, "Did he say why he wasn't at school today? We thought it rather queer when he didn't come, but perhaps, after the strange thing that happened yesterday..." This was precisely the trap into which the imp had planned that they should fall. "I didn't ask him," she remarked, with exasperating calm. "No doubt you didn't," retorted Carol heatedly, "but perhaps he told you without being asked." "Perhaps he did," returned the imp, "and perhaps he told me a lot more. However, I must say bye-bye for the present. I've got to go and study my lesson somewhere where I won't be disturbed." She scrambled down and sailed out of the room, waving airily to them from the doorway. "Isn't she simply maddening?" exclaimed Sue. "The idea of saying she had to go and study. I never knew."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.